You've heard a lot about transitioning, people transitioning from one gender to another. Oh, a guy was transitioning into being a gal, and a gal is transitioning into being a guy. And why? Because they don't feel special enough. So they think, if I just was a woman, I'd feel more special. So what we're doing here is we're transitioning out of specialness to normalcy. So we're doing our own transitioning. Everybody's into transitioning right now. And so we're the cutting edge of transitioning. We're transitioning out of the belief in specialness to normalcy. And what happens when you set down the belief in specialness? You're normal. You're normal. You realize your normalcy. And this is a great thing, because what is specialness? See, this is the question. As you transition out of specialness, the belief in specialness, just a belief, to normalcy, you begin to say, hey, this is a great deal. You know, gone is death, gone is sickness, gone is infirmity, gone is fear, gone is vulnerability. All those are our beliefs in specialness, meaning those are not things that we normally have. Because I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And as spirit, I don't have any sickness or death or vulnerability or confusion or fear or isolation, despair, depression, confusion, you whatever. I don't have any of that. So it's completely normal to be absolutely free of all of that. So normalcy isn't a bad deal at all, is it? In fact, it's a really great deal. So it's our belief in specialness that entails all of this nastiness that we don't really like at all. So what the so-called spiritual path is this transitioning back to normalcy, which we never really left, except we sort of had a dream of specialness. It's just been a dream. It's an imagination. It's been imagination. We're still normal. Everything is fine. But we have this bad hangover of specialness, so we're letting that hangover dissipate here. Now, why did we have this dream of specialness in the first place? Well, as the all-inclusive oneness, we, spirit, you can call us, thought, hey, I have this idea. This seems like a very wildly adventurous idea. Let's be greater than the all-inclusiveness. Let's be more inclusive than the all-inclusiveness. Meaning that there's some perspective, awareness outside of the all-inclusiveness. That's beyond it. But the problem is when spirit wanted to experience what is beyond what is all-inclusive, what happens is you become unaware of the all-inclusiveness. This is the only way you can imagine you're beyond it, is to be unaware of it. Because there is no beyond it. See, if there was a beyond it, then you could be in a position of being beyond it and be aware of the all-inclusiveness also. But since there isn't any beyond what is all-inclusive, to imagine yourself that you are beyond it ends up with this experiencing of blank mindness, so to speak. Blank mindness. You're not experiencing the all-inclusiveness at all. It seems life seems to have disappeared. Reality seems to have disappeared. And when this happens, we feel this feeling of, this is wrong. I don't like this. This is something is wrong. I don't like this. What happened? Reality's disappeared. And we have this conflict within us, this feeling like this isn't right. We call this guilt. Guilt. We have this deep spiritual guilt, like, this isn't right. Something's wrong. This isn't right. Now, what we did, instead of recognizing that this is because there is no beyond all-inclusiveness, out of our desire to experience being greater than God, we said, oh, okay, guilt is the problem. Okay, The effect is the problem instead of the cause. The cause was our desire to be greater than God, but we said, and guilt was the effect. But then we thought, oh, okay, there's a problem here with this, and if we can get rid of this problem, this effect called guilt, then we'll be able to experience what is being beyond the all-inclusiveness. So we dreamed up a very clever scheme, at least we think it's clever, very complex scheme, but basically it has to do with time, space, process, and form. We dreamed up time, space, process, and form. And we said that this was separate from us, separate from spirit. So we dreamed up, we'd imagine that bodies, let's say for instance, bodies, okay? And we think that bodies are separate from spirit. They're outside of our mind. They're beyond the mind. Just as we think we're beyond all the all-inclusivity of mind. We said, yeah, there's these bodies, process, worlds, bodies, process, time, space, process, form. All of this is outside of the mind, you know. And oh, how fortunate. And then we said, hey, all we need to do is project the guilt onto the bodies, okay? For example, let's project guilt onto a body and say that guilt is part of the body. It's the body that's feeling the guilt. It's time, space, process, form, worlds, bodies that are feeling the guilt. That's where it is. So we mentally believe we could project the guilt onto bodies, and now they belong to bodies, okay? Then we said, hey, you know, now we know how to get rid of guilt, right? And you probably already know what I'm going to say. Kill the body. Kill the body. When the body dies, everything that is part of the body dies with it. And the guilt dies with the death of the body. This is what we have imagined. So, that in a nutshell is exactly the whole enchilada. And of course it doesn't work, because effects cannot leave their source, cannot leave their cause. The cause of guilt is not the body. It is spirit desiring and attempting to be greater than God. And then having this feeling of blank mind, because there's nothing beyond the all-inclusive. So what it's experienced is basically nothing. You know, it tries to, and it feels guilty about this, feels wrong. This isn't how it's created to function, something's wrong. And instead of just admitting, say, oh yeah, this is because I tried to be greater than God, it says, no, I think this is a problem I can solve. And so this world, essentially this world, bodies, time, space, process, form, is a scapegoat. It's what's called a scapegoat. This is the whole idea of scapegoat. It's a sacrifice, sacrificial scapegoat. And what spirit is trying to do is project guilt onto the sacrificial scapegoat. So it now says, oh, that's where the guilt is. It's not in my mind at all. It's in the body. See, it's in the body. That's then kill the body. Guilt kills, dies with the body. Gone. You see, this is what we're trying to do. Full stop in the wow. As we talk here, sometimes we just full stop in the wow, because this is very heady information, very wowish information, actually. We're not used to hearing this explained so simply and easily and clearly. And we say, wow, we must be getting close to something here. Yeah, see, the wow kicks in when we feel like, hey, we must be getting really close to something really big here. And then we sort of tighten up a little bit. We do the Archie Bell and the drills, tighten up. And so then we just kind of say, okay, I'm tightening up. Wow, this is really something. Because we're starting to feel the ramifications. Like, hey, holy cow, this is true. Now, what did Jesus say across almost the last words before it is done or something? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Okay, so what they were doing with Jesus is sacrificial scapegoat. Okay, they were saying, you know, we've been trying to sacrifice the body and get rid of guilt, and it's just not working. We keep trying, project our guilt. Project our guilt onto bodies, sacrifice the body. We have temple sacrifices. It used to be projected onto people, humans, bodies. Then we project them onto animals, bring the animal in, slaughter the animal. There's a scapegoat for our sins, for our feeling of guilt, spiritual guilt. And we think that cures us, but it wasn't working, because it doesn't work. And so they said, we need it to work. We got to have this work. This has to work. This is our salvation. Once this works, then we'll be able to experience being greater than God. So they said, God, what we need is we need this to work. Actually, we told ourselves this. We have to get this to work. How do we get this to work? Well, they said, we have to have one instance where it does work. We have to have like a perfect sacrifice where it actually does work. We project the guilt onto a body, kill the body, and then the guilt is gone forever. This is our holy grail of belief that we have. Rather than just forgiving ourselves for the folly of trying to be greater than God, we outsmart ourselves. We keep thinking, no, we can get rid of the guilt somehow. Have our cake and eat it too. So, projecting the guilt upon a body and then killing the body. So what they did with Jesus is they said, okay, let's just believe that this is going to work. We're going to project our guilt onto the body of Jesus, crucify the body of Jesus, and that is going to get rid of guilt forever. This is the belief. And they said, we just have to believe it's true that God actually created this sacrifice, that somehow God created a body that we could project guilt upon and it would actually be part of the body. This is a magical belief, and then by killing that body, it really will get rid of guilt. But Jesus' next to last words is on the cross saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Meaning they don't know, this is a travesty. They're completely confused. This sacrifice is total confusion. They don't know what they're doing. So they don't know what they're doing. Obviously what they're doing isn't going to work. And then of course the purpose of Jesus going through this was the resurrection. And saying, hey, look folks, that doesn't work. Okay, so let's get to work on what does work. So it's the resurrection that's crucially important. In our frantic beliefs, we got to get rid of guilt, got to get rid of guilt through sacrifice. We're always thinking that someday God, our own creativity really is what we're saying. Our own creativity is going to be able to create a perfect sacrifice that will work. This is our frantic belief. And then when we think we've done that, then you say, all you got to do is you just got to keep believing it, keep having faith. It's going to, and then it will work in you. You'll feel, oh, I'm free of guilt now because we killed guilt. The death of the body killed guilt. So you say, well, I still have the desire to be beyond the all-inclusive, but now I don't have the guilt. Somehow I managed to get rid of it by killing it. Not true. It doesn't work. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I mean, they're bunglers. Now, when he said, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. Now, it's very important. The crucifixion of Jesus was Jesus showing us that God's love for us has not changed in the slightest bit, has not diminished, has not been altered in the slightest bit just because we tried to be greater than God, and now we're trying to maintain this idea of being greater than God by sacrificing guilt, projecting on a body and sacrificing a body to get rid of the guilt, which is of course insanity. That God's love for us has not diminished in the slightest bit. This is what Jesus was pointing out. So if he would have said, no, I don't want to be sacrificed, then people would say, oh, God's angry at us. God's angry at us. But he says, no, God's not angry at you. Even though You've been pursuing this totally whimsical folly, silliness, insanity. God's love for us has not diminished or changed in the slightest, but indeed it cannot. It cannot. It cannot. It's impossible. So basically, Jesus reassured everyone forever that we need not fear God, that God somehow is judging us because of this madcap nonsense that we're engaged in. Trying to get rid of guilt by projecting it onto time-space process form and then crucifying, killing time-space process and form. It's all an imaginary dream. God is not angry. There's no anger in God. There's no diminishment of God's love. There's no diminishment of God's love whatsoever for us. And so this is tremendously helpful to recognize this. So, we need not fear God's disapproval or God's loss of love just because we've been engaged in such nonsense. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Right? You don't get rid of an effect by projecting it on imaginary screen of form, time-space process form, then crucifying the screen and saying that the effect is gone. We get rid of the effect by dropping the cause. And the cause is our adventurous desire to say, hey, maybe I can be greater than God. Maybe I can be beyond the all-inclusiveness. Of course, then we feel excluded. So wait a minute. I feel so excluded. What? I feel this exclusionary feeling. And what is that? It's terrible. It's terrible. It's terrible. I gotta get rid of that. I feel very guilty. This is exclusionary feeling. It's not right. I feel guilty. So, the belief that the body can accept the guilt and the guilt be part of the body is called belief in specialness. So, the belief that the body can be sick, we see that as a sign the body has guilt. The belief that the body can die, we feel that is proof that the body has the guilt, contains the guilt, the spiritual guilt. And so, that gives us hope that we can get rid of the guilt, the death of the body, the sickness of the body, the death of the body. We believe this is all getting rid of the guilt for us. But we realize that it hasn't worked. But we say, well, we just have to keep working at it. You know, it has to be more death and more death and more death. And the whole universe is a sacrificial machine. And we just keep going with greater and greater deathness. And we say, well, maybe we need a whole bunch of people to die, like, all together. Or in a short period of time. We need massacres. We need this, we need that, and that'll work. So we've tried all sorts of stuff. Well, we need some terrible illness, some plagues. We need some global catastrophe, like a pole shift. You know, we need something. So we keep on thinking, how do we get rid of guilt by killing bodies? Crucifying form, time-space process form. How do we get rid of guilt by crucifying it in form. And so we keep dreaming up, and this dream continues on and on and on and on and on. And we think that, well, maybe if it just millions and billions of years of death adding up, we'll finally get it done. So we think, and so we sort of go with gradualism. So, well, there's gradualism, and there's also maybe we just haven't had a big enough sacrifice, you know, a massive sacrifice where, you know, billions of people die all at the same, bodies die all at the same time, something like that. And so we're working on that dream too. We're working on the gradualism, the suddenness, you might call it punctuated evolution or punctuated death, where constant death, and then sudden extreme death, you know, extinction events, ELDs, extinction level events. And this is what the world is. This world is nothing but a scapegoat, an imaginary scapegoat that we are imagining in order to take the guilt away from us. And this is the good news, actually. We're not... Time-space processing form is just a screen, like a movie screen, that we're projecting guilt onto. We feel we can get rid of our guilt that way. All guilt is spiritual guilt. And all spiritual guilt is the desire to be greater than God, to be separate from God. And this brings up a feeling of somehow that we're excluded. We've been excluded. Because there isn't anything greater than, more inclusive than what's all-inclusive. All-inclusiveness is always all-inclusiveness. And to say that there's something beyond that is to be unaware of all-inclusiveness. And then we feel excluded. We feel guilty. Something's wrong with us. We feel guilty. There's something wrong with me. I feel excluded. So we just need to what? Repent means to change our mind instead of trying to project and sacrifice the guilt. Just choose a different idea. Say, hey, I don't need to be greater than God. I can just be normal. So it's really a transition. Repentance is just a transition back to normalcy. And once we no longer are trying to be more inclusive than all inclusiveness, we then shift into normalcy and we realize, oh, I'm in all inclusiveness. So the feeling of being excluded vanishes for us. But we have a little problem here with a continuity fear, because we have a feeling of being excluded, objectifying everything. Everything seems objectified to us. And then we feel, no, there's only this all one, perfect one subjectivity, as it were, all inclusiveness. That's it's a big, seemingly big transition there. So we sort of gradually make this transition. Don't do it all in one day. So normalcy is great, you see. Normalcy, again, all the indications that somehow we've been able to project guilt successfully don't need to be there at all. The sickness, the aging, the infirmity, the vulnerability, the fear, the terror, the despair, the tribulations, the trials, everything that we seem to be going through that is so... All of that is simply what we believe are indications that guilt has been successfully projected onto bodies. But when we transition to normalcy, we realize we don't need to project guilt at all. We don't need any of those indications. So I am perfectly normal. I am flawlessly normal right now. I am flawlessly normal right now. I'm absolutely, perfectly, flawlessly normal right now. There is no need to project guilt to get rid of it. I simply forgive myself for the silly misadventure of trying to be more inclusive than all inclusiveness. That's all. I just accept that I'm normal. I don't need to try to become abnormal. So when we drop abnormality, what do we have? We have normality. We have normality. So all this in a nutshell is the good news, is the gospel. And we have to go as quickly as we can in this transition, but don't get discouraged if you feel like, it's dragging. Yeah. The world being nothing but a reflection of our hope that we can project guilt and kill it, destroy it that way. Obviously, we feel that being here, that we need to participate in this charade. So, otherwise we think that we'll stick everybody with guilt, but this isn't so. We'll help them transition back to normalcy is what we'll help them with. Since being greater than everything doesn't work, then there's no guilt attached to us. Because we failed, we're not guilty. We're not lesser just because we failed to try to be greater. Doesn't mean we're lesser. So that means there isn't any one greater than us. So the all inclusiveness is still all inclusive, perfect all inclusiveness. Therefore, there isn't any guilt in reality. There's no cause for guilt in reality whatsoever, and we cannot cause guilt in reality at all. Other than our attempt to be greater in reality, but that doesn't change reality. It's just a an imaginary scenario that we're considering, a hypothetical scenario. We're still normal. All is still included. We're still all-inclusive. All is included. No exclusions. Even though we tried to exclude ourselves, it doesn't work. And the attempts to make it work, they don't work either. So all is good. All is fine. So transitioning back to normalcy, it seems to be quite a challenge. But the more we clarify this, the easier it gets. Now, there have been some normal spirits here, spirit and normal spirit here in the world. Occasionally, normal spirit shows up in this world with a body, and it's like, wow, what is this? And we think they're very abnormal, but it's actually us that are in the very abnormal belief in abnormality. So we just said, well, they're quite different attitude. Always blissful, nothing seems to bother them. Everything's great, everything's perfect, and no guilt at all. It's just, and so we don't understand them very easily. It's a real puzzlement to us, real puzzlement. Most people just avoid them altogether because it's too much of a challenge. It's like, this is interfering with my specialness, you know, my ability to sacrifice guilt. So most everyone in the world has this great strong belief that they have the capacity to sacrifice guilt, and they're going to succeed at that. And so that keeps them enmeshed in this sacrificial dream. But it's actually easy to transition out of it. There aren't any real blocks at all. It's just our nervousness and jitters, like, wow, I don't know if I can transition back to normalcy or not. We think we become so abnormal through all this projection on the time-space process and form that we wonder, maybe I really am abnormal now. Maybe my spirit has changed. No. So those spirits who come here who are normal, they reassure us that no, your spirit hasn't changed at all. Don't worry, it hasn't changed in the slightest bit. And that's helpful. It's very helpful. Very helpful. So when we use our reason like this to look at it, this softens up the whole situation, loosens it up. Not so tight. Not so tight. Not so fearful. But we also still have a tendency to pull back to the familiarity of projecting guilt is still there. The pull back to the belief in specialness, abnormality. It's easy to slip back into bad habits like that. But this explanation, ability to explain it like this, means that our minds must be, you know, seemingly okay, right? If we can see it this clearly, then how abnormal could we possibly be? We're probably perfectly normal. And those who, normal spirits, assure us that we're all perfectly normal, absolutely assure us that we are, all of us, perfectly normal. Nobody has been able to exclude themselves, and no one will ever be able to exclude themselves, no matter how much sacrifice it takes place in this dream of imaginary dream of sacrifice. It will have no effect on any of us, and no one will be excluded in the slightest bit. Seeing this is called a vision of oneness, and I have seen it several times. What I see is like, oh my gosh, everyone is perfectly included. I see this perfect inclusive. No one's excluded. In fact, there's no possibility anyone will ever be excluded. Doesn't matter how many bodies they project and kill. And keep in mind that the body is just a dream, a figment of spiritual imagination. So, it does the body actually die? No. But we keep believing that if we believe the body's real and it actually dies, then that proves that we got rid of the guilt. Now the body just appears to be born and grow, and then it appears to age and die. It's all just like a dream. It's just a dream in the mind of spirit. It's no more dying than it is living. It appears to be well and then appears to be sick. It's no more well than it is sick. And it's no more sick than it is well. The body doesn't have any independent attributes. Just like a dream figure in a dream doesn't have any independent attributes. All attributes of a dream figure come 100% from the dream, from the one who's doing the dreaming. So if the one who's doing the dreaming can't die, there's no way that the death of any dream figures is real. It's just simply wishful thinking. So the truth is, no, nothing's ever died. There's never been any death at all. There's never been any specialness at all. But we can believe, keep believing there is. So all we're doing is we're dropping this belief in specialness. But this is difficult for those who insist that there has been specialness somehow, and independent of our dream. And then therefore the sacrifice of guilt is possible or has already taken place or something like that. That is very difficult to accept. There's never been any specialists. That hit me really hard there. I was not able to stop that. Okay, so well, maybe just back off of this. This is agitating people too much. Well, no need to agitate. So, but ultimately, that has to occur. We already know that there's no such thing as any dream figure independent of the dream. This arises from our desire to be independent of reality, to be independent of all-inclusiveness. So that we just then continue this thinking, oh yeah, we can have a dream figure independent of our dreaming. And we cannot. There isn't any dream figure that is outside of the dream. But since we believe that we're outside of reality, we don't have any problem believing there's some dream figure outside of our dreaming. Jesus said, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." Because Jesus says, they think that I'm outside of the dream. That this body is outside of the dreaming of body, outside of the dream. That this dream figure body is outside of the dream of dream figure bodies. Therefore, they think that by crucifying this body, the death of guilt will take place. And so he says, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." They're deluded. In other words, they're completely deluded. They think this body's outside of the dream because Jesus had a normal, was normal, you see. And they took this normalcy for like, ah, here's a body that's outside of the dream. But a body is just neutral. So all bodies continue to be dream bodies, physical, flesh, time, space, process, form. It's still a dream, just a dream figure. But bodies have no value in themselves whatsoever. However, the body can be used as a communication device. So we can say, well, at least it has that value of being a communication device, communicating the truth. But there are no bodies in the world, so to speak, that are outside of the dream, so to speak. They're all part of the dream, see? Even the bodies of spirit, of normalcy, spirit's normal. What happens there is they just say the body's nothing. I don't even identify with the body at all. The mistake is to believe that the body of a spirit that is normal, who appears in this world, So they need a body to appear in this world. The belief that therefore that body is somehow special. You see? And is outside of the dream, okay, of bodies. And therefore, that the death of that body would be real, and then could project guilt on that and kill that body real. That's the mistake. That's the mistake. That's the mistake we make. So it's sort of a catch-22, because when we see a spirit that's transitioned to normalcy, well, the body then reflects that normalcy. But just like a mirror is reflecting, the mirror is not causing what's being reflected in the mirror at all. If we take it that the body's somehow causing that because we want the body to be causative, then we'll make the mistake of thinking, hey, we can project guilt on this body and sacrifice this body, and that will get rid of guilt. That's the fundamental mistake. So Jesus said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They're making a fundamental mistake. Example, fundamental. Here's an example of a normal spirit. Sri Sri Ananda Mahima was spirit accepting that it was normal, totally normal. So had a body here, and they asked her, well, you know, what's your body want to do? And this normal spirit said, I've never ever for one moment identified with this body at all. This she body is a female body. Never have identified with this body whatsoever. Bodies has no desire of its own whatsoever. And this normal spirit said to those asking, if it weren't for you wanting me to be here so that I can help you transition back to normalcy, this body would simply lie in a heap like a rag doll, limp rag doll, or a heap of rags in the corner of the room, and be like in a frozen condition, and wouldn't move at all, wouldn't do anything at all. And indeed, when people stopped asking for help in transitioning, that's exactly what happened to the body. The body would just lie in a heap and be completely inert, and touch us like frozen, like ice. See, and this normal spirit said, the body has no desires, plans, hope. This body has no desires, hopes, plans, nothing. It's just a prop, like a rag doll. It's nothing more than a rag doll. It is simply a prop. But this is the correct perspective on a normal spirit actually having a prop, body prop in this world to help us with our transitioning to spiritual normalcy. That's the proper perspective, actually. So when people try to take the mirror as causing the reflection in the mirror, then that body would just become inert. Many times it would just become inert because they're, you know, just showing them, no, you're fundamentally confused. You're going back to fundamental confusion. The body at best would just be like a mirror reflecting the normalcy of spirit. But a mirror, again, is not causing what is being reflected in it. What is being reflected in the mirror is actually there, independent of the mirror. It doesn't need the mirror to be there. See, we can't make that mistake. As soon as we start worshiping the mirror, oh, mirror, mirror, mirror on the wall, you know, you're the cause of this. That's a fundamental mistake. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They're making a fundamental mistake here, spiritual mistake. But, again, God's love for us does not diminish in the tiniest bit or change, can never change for us, can never change. So we have to forgive ourselves for making these fundamental mistakes. Instead of trying to keep projecting the guilt and sacrificing, project, sacrifice, project, sacrifice, project, sacrifice. It doesn't work, as we know. As some of us know, and some of us are still hoping that it's going to work. So, since the body is already just a dream figure, it's inherently you can say it's inherently neutral. It's a symbol. And the symbols are inherently neutral, actually. The only meaning they have is the meaning we ascribe to them. They don't have any problem. It's neutral. Again, we just imagine bodies as a scapegoat device. But we don't have to use it as a scapegoat device. Since it has no meaning of its own at all, we're perfectly free to use it another way. Use it as a mere reflecting on our normalcy. Absolutely, we can do that. But then don't think that somehow the body has something to do with anything. How can a dream figure we're dreaming have something to do with us, the dreamer? It doesn't. So the body, we can use it to believe that, you know, in specialness, we're projecting guilt on it, or we can use it to reflect normalcy. Either way, the body's not doing anything. Is it possible to transition from the belief in specialness to the belief in normalcy? Absolutely is possible. That's what I've been working on. Come a long way in that. It's done by allowing our mind to listen to the voice of reason. And what we do then is we start looking with our mind. We start looking at seeing what our mind is trying to do. instead of keep believing in this specialness and form, we look at the mind, examine the mind. Who is the one looking in the mirror? What are you trying to see in the mirror? Everything you're seeing in the mirror is actually is already in the mind first. So look at the mind. How is the mind defending? What is it trying to do? You look at the mind carefully and you begin to recognize, like, wow, this is what's really going on. And of course, teachers give us pointers. Those who are normal, who accepted that they're normal, give us pointers to help us transition to normalcy. And there's nowhere else to go, actually. There's nowhere else to go. This projection of guilt and sacrificial gain doesn't go anywhere. Except more projection, more sacrifice. and more battles. And says, hey, we successfully sacrificed. No, we did. You know, we gotta sacrifice you because you're interfering with our sacrifice. See, the sacrifice is just a belief, and belief is unstable. It's just a dream. So dreams are unstable, right? Because the dreamer can change anything in the dream at all. So people who think they successfully sacrificed guilt, they feel very inherently insecure and jittery about this. Of course, because you can't do it. And so, of course, they get very angry at others who have some other idea. No, you got to believe what we believe, or we got to crush you, you know. We got to sacrifice you, and that will uphold our sacrifice. So you have sacrifice, upholding sacrifice, upholding sacrifice, upholding sacrifice. And it's just a nightmare. It's just a nightmare. This is what's going on and on and on and on and on and on and on. So, time to transition back to normalcy. Thank God. So we have these transitional appearances that help us with our transitioning from time to time. Occasionally, they show up in this world. Occasionally, they don't seem to show up so much. I don't know, but this is all part of the transitioning. That we are spirit is what we are advising. We advise ourselves. That's called the Holy Spirit. We're really advising ourselves because we do know the truth. And this self-advice we're giving is what we call the Holy Spirit. God reassured us that all is well, and this reassurance enables us to give ourselves advice, Holy Spirit, advising Spirit. And so we're going towards this transition, but it's difficult from our perspective to see everything that's involved, because it's all inclusive. It's all inclusive. So there's what we have to do is just keep from our vantage point, keep doing the best we can to follow the inner advice in this transition back to normalcy. But we don't feel like we have it all under control. It just doesn't feel that way, because it involves the totality of this dream. Because it all of us have to transition. So it's not just one of us, it's all of us. And so the transition of one back to normalcy is interwoven also somehow into being helpful for the transition of all in some way. So it's very, if we start thinking about it too much, we'll get overwhelmed by it. We don't need to. We just need to allow our transition to take place by our continued work to clarify and accept and get used to this and move our comfort zone. So a body of one who has transitioned back to normalcy, they just say, oh, it's no longer special at all. This is, you might say, quote unquote, a normal body, meaning just a neutral. That's a little confusing, because the body's always neutral. It's always neutral. So it's really just reflecting a normal mind, a normal spirit now, whereas before it was reflecting a spirit trying to be abnormal or special. But you could say that the normal mind is no longer trying to project specialness upon the body, so that the body will seem to be very fresh and will have this feeling of freshness to it. And this is very noticeable. And people will just say, wow. Stop right in their tracks, just wow. And whether the body appears to be this age or that age, the freshness is there. The normalcy is there. There's no special, there's no trace of specialness in the mind that the body's reflecting. So it reflects this wonderful freshness, that there is no aging, sickness, dying, boundness to time, space, process, or form at all. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So what you have is you feel this freshness. Now the body can just be just sitting there, not doing anything, just quietly sitting there. But there's this presence of freshness that is not of this world, so to speak. Is not of specialness, not of the dream of specialness. You can call it a dream of normalcy, since there seems still a body reflecting it, a dream of normalcy. But certainly dreaming of normalcy, dreaming of normal, is a wonderful segue into accepting that I already am perfectly normal. So there's this inexplicable freshness. And indeed, in terms of specialness, it is inexplicable. And the only way to explain it is this is normalcy. See? And that means you do need to experience this. You do need to transition to normalcy. So the problem is you have this freshness. There are those who say, yeah, I want this, I want this, I want this too. I want to have my cake and eat it too. I want to still try to be special, but I want to have also this feeling of freshness. That's when the wheels start coming off. And they think, no, I don't have to transition back to normalcy. I can maintain specialness, but still, but I can somehow, by accepting some other successful sacrifice, then I'll be able to feel this freshness. And that's when the trouble starts. Scream sour grapes at that point. You know, if you say no, that's not it, then sour grapes arise. How dare you deceive us and making us think we could have this? And then, da, da, da. No, they're the ones who think they can have this through sacrifice. The ones who are normal never say that. That is so. Absolutely not. You have it by transitioning to normalcy, giving up the dream of specialness and just a projection of guilt and scapegoating, giving up that dream. So the freshness will be there. Not everybody will like that. Not everybody will accept it. Not everybody will see it in the right context at all. Some will completely twist it, you know, opposite of what it is about. But some will get it. Say, hey, this feels like normal to me. This is like, yeah, this reminds me of something. Or what does it remind me of? Oh, it reminds me of normalcy. Oh, yeah, being normal. I want to be normal. How do I be normal again? I've forgotten. And, oh, let me be reminded. Is any one body better reflecting than another? No, bodies are neutral. There's no way one body can be better than another. They're neutral, symbolic dream figures. It's the mind, spirit, that's reflecting. And spirit has no gender whatsoever, none. So we have to drop this silliness of thinking that one gender is better at being neutral than some other gender. It's not true at all. It's not true at all. We go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. It's all nonsense. The answer is neither. The body is simply completely neutral, and it's just reflecting what is in the mind. And mind has absolutely no gender whatsoever. Zero. Not a trace of it, actually. The problems do arise is in any culture there's biases, and people want those biases to be reflected. And so, to some extent, to simply appear anywhere as perfectly normal, such as normal, anandamai, there will seem to be some biases there. Otherwise, the people couldn't reject it. The pure normalcy, they did reject it. They say, no, you need to reflect our traditions, our beliefs, you belong to us. This is, you know, this is part of the problem. And we have to account for that. So there's really not many, if at all, it seems as though there is a bias. Now, I have to say, Ramana Maharshi seemed to be more independent of culture than most. He simply sat there in silence. And so seems a little easier to relate to that example of normalcy, because he didn't do anything. He was not doing anything except just sitting there silently. Whereas normal Ananda Mai was intensely involved in all the families and all the culture and all the traditions of Hinduism and religion, all that, intensely involved because there was a need for help in that area. So that there tends to be reflected that seeming bias in that way. Now, if you can see past the bias, then that's fine. But many have trouble seeing past it. But with Ramana Maharshi, normal Ramana, that was normal spirit here in the world. It just seems like anyone could go to him, and you just feel just absolute silence. There doesn't seem to be any cultural filters there. Right, where with normal Ananda Mai, there's a lot of cultural filters there. And people from other countries had a great deal of difficulty trying to find her, trying to sit with her, trying to be engaged. You know, it was very, very difficult. But still, a perfect example of normal spirit for sure, and gave many incredible wealth of experiences showing normal spirit, tremendous. But Ramana Maharshi, there doesn't seem to be hardly any cultural biases at all. I don't feel any cultural biases. I just don't feel it. Just absolute silence. He's not professing. Even when he did profess a few teachings, he made it clear to those he had professed to that I'm not exclusively saying this or that. It's just this is what they want to hear. This is what's helpful for them. But I am not putting any sort of exclusivity on this style or that style or anything like that. So very useful, very useful, very helpful. They're all helpful, but different people tend to gravitate towards different examples of normal spirit based on what their familiarity is and their comfort zone is. So people from all sorts of backgrounds feel comfortable with Ramana Maharshi. They just feel this freshness, the silence, this freshness. It's the freshness is so perfect. You don't even need to comment on it. Doesn't need any comment. It's just wow. Freshness is not grounded in any ideology of specialness at all, or not even any tradition, really. It transcends that. So he really made no commentary on the freshness. It's just here. And he very correctly said, what needs to be said? It's complete, it's perfect, it's here. There's no need for commentary, actually, upon it. Just like we don't need to provide commentary on all-inclusiveness as if we were outside of all-inclusiveness, right? All-inclusiveness doesn't need commentary on what it is. This is what he was pointing out to us. So another great example. It depends, Westerners tend to be more independent, especially like a lot of Westerners, but Americans are very... I don't feel rooted in any family structure here as an American. I don't feel rooted in any tradition. Out in California, we, go west, go west, go west. We, out here we feel Free, independent, not rooted in, I don't feel rooted in anything, to tell you the truth. I don't even feel rooted in this world. So someone like that is very helpful. Because you don't feel you have to, you know, it's just a silence, just like no root, no rootedness. The silence is its own rootedness. It doesn't mean in traditional backgrounds, like in India, traditions going thousands of years of family traditions, lineages, guru lineages, teaching lineages. I mean, they're tremendously rooted in this. And so an example of normalcy appeared to help them out with those who were needing that. They needed someone who reflected their traditions, their ancestry, the teachings they've been using, in the place where, with India, the place where they live. They needed someone to reflect that to them. This is where they're biased, and they needed some help to get past that. So that was normal. Nandamayi helped out with that. Helped out with that a great deal. Whereas those who feel much more rootless and independent, I can't really point to any tradition at all. You know, some Judeo-Christianity, but still even feel somehow, you know, independent of all traditions. Well, Ramana Maharshi is not saying anything. He's not representing, he's not trying to represent some tradition, really. It's just the silence. So Westerners tended to be more attracted to that. Also, Srinivasagadatta Maharaj said, forget all that, you know, tradition, you know, it's nonsense, come on, get past that. And so he also was Westerner, said, oh, we can, this is something we can approach, feel more easy, at ease with. So silence is not rooted in any tradition whatsoever. The freshness is not rooted in any tradition. How can it be rooted in tradition? All tradition is simply the bias of the dream, to some extent, right? Is the dreamer rooted in the dream? Is the dreamer really rooted in the dream? And the answer is no, of course. Not in any way. See, the dream is like a substitute for reality for us. Thinking, yeah, okay, we the dreamer are dreaming this dream. That's like we think we spirit are now external to all inclusiveness, and we're aware of it, like as if we're creating it or something. So we have this dream, but we think that we're outside of the dream that we're dreaming. But no, the dream is actually we're causing it. It's not separate from us. So we can never be rooted in a dream. It's not possible. We can never be rooted in our own imagination. So we did not need to put the freshness into some tradition, actually, ultimately. So for me, I feel I don't represent any specific tradition at all, actually. And there are those like this who you can talk of this tradition and Buddhism and Hinduism, Christianity, everything, but you're not really rooted in it. You're not really rooted. So I don't need to be rooted in that at all. I don't need to see myself as rooted in that at all. Then just the freshness that is just present, we don't need to try and reverse engineer. Where did it come from? How did we dream of this? You know, how do we dream of this? This is just a reflection of normalcy. It's like saying, how do we become normal? We've always been normal. So you could say, well, how did we set down abnormality? Well, by clarity. By clarity, that's all. Well, what tradition of clarity? Well, clarity is within us. So, simply sitting quietly, carefully examining. If you want to call that tradition, sit quietly. But See, people have this fear. If they don't feel rooted in the dream, they fear like that maybe they'll be stuck with the guilt. You see, so they're very nervous about that. So Jesus showed up to the Judaism, and within that tradition of sacrificing scapegoats and all that, and help them out, and then also through extension help out the Roman Empire and the Gentiles, etc. They needed that type of help. They wanted to have their own traditions somewhat validated, or at least not rejected, see, like that. They don't reject our sacrificial traditions, which go way back, you know, thousands of years actually. But for me, I don't feel any need to do anything like that. I don't need to reflect these biases or in that way. And it's just let the freshness be there, that's all. I think just our path is our tradition. We are our own tradition. Is simply our spiritual path becomes the tradition, the rootedness that we have. When you have your own spiritual path, you feel you are rooted as much as you need to be in whatever you need to be rooted in. You're rooted in sanity. You're rooted in discipline. You're rooted in clarity. You're rooted in reason. For those who think that somehow tradition will do it for them, then there's a problem there, right? And I don't want to jump into that. That is for sure. Who wants to jump into that? But leave that for the Jesus and Anandamayi and those who, you know, Longchenpa, the superstars of normalcy, so to speak. We'll leave that for them. Okay, let's leave that for them, because that is a real tough go for sure. Because you realize that you're going to have all these flex and biases, and you cannot get caught up in those biases at all. See, that's the trick. I looked at the normal Anandamayi, as I call it, normal Anandamayi, and it's incredible how the play of these biases, normal Anandamayi wouldn't have this enormous play of all this tradition and biases, and yet not get caught up in it at all, instant by instant by instant by. So, my gosh, yeah, that's a superstar of normalcy, to say the least. Same with Jesus, you know, how did he do what he did? It is a superstar normalcy. We don't have to be that kind of superstars of normalcy like that. We do not have to align ourselves with some tradition to uplift some whole entire tradition, you know, like that. That is an epic work. We can simply be fresh right now, allow the normalcy to be reflected in the mirror of this body. Right now, we don't have to align it with anything. It's not necessary. Especially if the Holy Spirit advises us, it's not necessary at all. It doesn't make you any less normal than the superstars' normalcy. It's just that the superstars of normalcy have been accepted their normalcy to a perfect extent, which then enables them to function the way they did. Now, in the case of normal Anandamayi, the testimony there was that this one had never, ever taken the path of abnormality in the first place. So it was like complete, perfect, beyond familiarity. There's not even an issue of familiarity. And so we can't, having taken the path of abnormality, we cannot do that. Because we still have to let the echoes of the dream of specialness fade, 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 fade. And it can take quite quite a while for all of those echoes to fade away. And even then, there's a final step. Whereas someone who's never ever took the path of separation at all, they can come into this world and seem to function in an extraordinary way to uplift, you know, to somehow burn off so much unnecessary identification and rootedness, so to speak. They can be like that, but we're not that. So we say we have to let the echoes die down. Okay, so we don't have to identify with any tradition. Okay, in fact, I advise even not to. I don't feel like I need to. I don't even identify with the Course in Miracles tradition. Actually, it's certainly been very helpful. Well, the advice has been helpful, but I don't feel rooted in that book, our tradition, our words, or anything about it. I feel rooted in my own discipline and determination and inner knowing and the Holy Spirit. I feel rooted in the Holy Spirit, really. But the Holy Spirit of my own desire to be free of suffering. Yeah. So maybe this is a breakthrough help for everyone, is we can have this tradition-free tradition, so to speak, of, hey, I don't have to identify with any tradition. This is just unidentified freshness. This is just freshness as it is. I don't need the beard and the dreads and the malas and Arunachala or Rikshikesh or, you know, all the... I don't need that. Just be, you know, average suburban Joe or Mary or whatever. Just be just your average, not really identifying with any tradition at all. Because I know I'm not rooted in the dream at all, actually. So, if people want those who are rooted in their traditions, I just say, well, you needed someone who's more heavyweight than I am then. I can't do that for you. Cannot do that for you. I'm still letting the echoes die down, you see. And so, but those who say, you know, I just like to let the echoes die down too, and I don't really want to feel, you know, rooted in this any particular tradition, because it carries so much baggage with it. I just want to be fresh right now. I want to be free right now. I want to be normal right now, and not have that baggage and burden. And maybe I can be a good example at some point. And you know, just say, yeah, that's fine. Just do that. No alignment, no tradition, no rootedness, except rootedness in the work ethic, I would say. I would say I'm rooted in what I would call a spiritual work ethic. Simply getting it done every day. That's what I would put it as. You know, I never said, hey, my ancestors and my tradition has done so much great work, they did it for me, so I don't really need to work at it. I can just believe that they did it. I said, no. I gotta do it. I gotta get it done here. Nobody can do it for you. And this work ethic can work in any, from any which way, you know, it is whatever it is right now. This is the work. This is the opportunity right now. This is the opportunity, always. So I always felt the opportunity is always right in front of me, right here. Because my willingness is right here. And when you're willing, then you see the opportunity. Wow, opportunity is right here. So paradoxically, maybe historically, this approach doesn't tie in with any historic. You're not going to be some figure in some historic tradition. People, a lot of people support you and say, oh, this is great, the saint, this. Paradoxically, though, you may be more helpful to many more by just not aligning at all. And who's to say that all these traditions are going to continue on anyway in this world, actually? Tell you actually. The way things are going with the incorporation of this planet into the CCC, Cosmic Corporate Culture, actually. Those traditions are likely to be gone with the wind anyway. See? So. Normalcy, spirit, it doesn't have to be great in a dream. It's not rooted in a dream. Its normalcy is not rooted in the dream. Its normalcy is not rooted in any dream tradition. It's not rooted in time, space, process, and form at all. So since we're accepting our normalcy, all that's out the window, really. Do I feel like an American or something? No, I don't feel aligned with any country. I don't even feel aligned. I feel like I'm a member of the human species. No. Do I feel like I'm a member of this world? No. I don't feel aligned with this world or this universe or any country or gender or age or any ideology. I don't feel rooted in any of that. Don't feel aligned or rooted in any of that, really. Normalcy is rooted in normalcy and nothing else. That's the freshness. And the hope for sacrificial abnormality, abnormality which leads to sacrifice of guilt, is rooted in all these traditions of the dream, trying to feel that there's rootedness in the dream. There isn't any, actually. But, of course, those examples of normalcy that came to help seem to be biased in that way, but they need to, the people are so biased that they're trying to reach, that if they weren't biased, didn't appear to be biased at all, people would reject them. People would reject them. So we're not fooled by that. No one who's normal, who's come in this world, has been in error or mistaken at all, but they just took on the challenge, the compassion to help out in a large way because they had the capacity to do so. And therefore may have seemed to lean this way or that way pragmatically so they could at least have a chat with the folks, you know, say, hey folks, you need to kind of start gravitating this way, come on. Yeah, but you don't look like us, you don't think like us. Well, yeah, I think a little bit like you, look a little bit like you, and you know, come on this way, come on this way. Oh, okay, maybe you are a little bit like us, you know, like that. You have to be gradually led like that. But me living on the edge of the Pacific Ocean here in California, just like, we just, you know, tend to not feel very aligned with anything. State, you know, not very old. People look at Los Angeles, think, oh, it's been there forever. No, it's been, how long has Los Angeles been there? A little over 100 years or something. I mean, it was just, you know, 100 plus years ago, it was just a desert. It was absolute desert scrubland was all it was. It was a ranch. That area were ranches. That's all. Big cattle ranches, and not so much cattle, because it was a very dry desert. It was a desert. Los Angeles is plopped down. That whole Southern California is plopped down on a desert. East, very, very powerful, wealthy Eastern Anglican bankers, WASP bankers, they want to build a paradise here in the world. They wanted an ideal society, and they fashioned Los Angeles. They structured it, blueprinted it from the get-go. Libraries, civic centers, parks, public works, water, everything. They planned it all out ahead of time, actually. Many, many, many different communities had it all planned out in a large area there. They wanted to build like an ideal place on this planet. All they needed was water, and they got that. Owens Valley. San Francisco hasn't been here that long, right? Longer than Los Angeles, but so California is like very recent, super, super recent. Even the houses, all the houses here have no tradition to them. If we want to say anything with tradition, we got to go to like a mission, like Carmel Mission. There's various missions that were built by the Spaniards back way back when. But see, other than that, we don't have any buildings here that are tradition. None. Why? Because nobody, the Indians didn't build big buildings. They were sort of nomadic, and not entirely nomadic, but they were just hunter-gatherers. They didn't have big monumental, colossal stone buildings. And because of severe earthquakes here, we build all our homes in materials that can handle an earthquake. So we tend not to, you look at homes and roofs have to be replaced every, 20, 30 years. The houses themselves need to be replaced. Termites eat them up. Wood, we can't build stone and brick here, really. So everything seems like just recent and temporary, flimsy, recent here. And there's a very, for me, there's no feeling of rootedness and tradition at all here. It's pretty amazing. I look at Europe, and I can't believe it. But look at that. That building's been there a thousand years. Still there, and still looks in great shape. Well, they built with stone. Concrete, stone, brick, stuff that lasts thousands of years. And so you can feel the tradition there. Can feel it, right? The great temples, like of India, for instance, there's massive temples been there, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, maybe thousands of years. And people have been going to them for thousand years or more, the same place, and everything's the same. I mean, this has a profound effect on the psyche. But here in California, there's no buildings like that. We don't have any 5,000-year-old temples here. We got a church down the street that's 50 years old. And we say, wow, it's 50. I think the church was celebrating its 100th. Actually, no, the church that I know of is actually, it's about 60 years old, something like that. And we say, this church is 60 years old. People go, wow, that's an old church, 60 years. Now, what a tradition. We have a 60-year tradition. This church has been there for 60 years. You go to Rome, there's places that have been there 2,000 years. Other places are older than that. The buildings are still being used. Look at St. Peter's, Colossal, right? So the people who belong to that, they think they belong to this feeling of tradition. California, we don't feel any tradition. I don't feel any tradition at all. I don't feel I'm any part of any tradition at all. I mean, we have to spend all the time fixing our homes because they keep falling apart because there's no stone, mortar, concrete, and doggone termites get them. All sorts of stuff happens. The roofs, there's a big, 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 industry of replacing roofs out here. Okay, tear off the roof, put a new one on, just like that. Oh, this has gotten wet. Oh, this has gotten damaged. Oh, this is, remodel in California, because we know any moment the next big earthquake could strike. I mean, look what they did. They built San Francisco, tried to build it like it's going to last, and all these big buildings, kaboom. Yeah, 1906 earthquake. Poof, fire, brought it all down. So everything here is designed, and you don't feel a sense of tradition in California at all. Not compared to the rest of the world at all. Okay, so we don't have that. We just don't have that. We don't have these lineages from California. Oh yeah, the teacher's been teaching. The lineage goes back a couple thousand years here. And all the teachers and all the buildings and all the people tradition. No, nothing. Rootless here. We're rootless, we're traditionless. However, that can be a positive. Can be a very big positive if you can flip the script in and see it in the right perspective. It's like, wow, then I can be fresh right now. I don't need to try to explain the freshness, how it came out of this tradition, how it was rooted in this tradition. I don't need to explain how it's rooted in time, space, process, or form. It's not rooted in time, space, process, or form. But those who feel they are part of a tradition, they say, well, then that means our tradition doesn't mean anything. Well, traditions are means to an end. They're not end in themselves at all. So the whole purpose of those traditions is to make themselves unnecessary. That's the entire purpose of it. As Jesus so wonderfully said in the Course in Miracles, the whole purpose of this book is to make itself unnecessary. He said, I'm not giving this out of some tradition, starting some religion. No, the purpose is to make itself unnecessary. And he says, if you have done this, then you have learned this course well. And that is sufficient. So full stop in the wow. This is very heavy territory. Again, we're in this sort of starting to reverberate quite a bit. I'm getting close to something. Is what it means. Getting close to something really big, as it were. So you just accept it. Say, okay, well. When I'm ready, it'll come when I'm ready, and I'm not going to try and rush things, and just stay calm, stay patient, full stop in the wow. This is very much wow. You see, those who feel rooted in the traditions of this dream, if you're fresh, the freshness is there. If you're normal, if you've transitioned normalcy, they may say, "Bah, you can't be anywhere near as good as the teachers we have right now, because they're rooted in this tradition." You know, and so they will poo-poo you and dismiss you and say, "Oh, you're not important, not helpful." So you have to be able to get over that thing. You know. Any tradition will say, well, if you really want to make it, you need to be join us. That's where the tradition's at. If you really want to make it. Right. Not right. Keep in mind, it's very likely that the traditions in this world are coming to an end. Very likely. I'm not prophesizing that or predicting it. I'm just saying there's some likelihood, quite a bit of likelihood, that that's very, very possible. In various ways. And so what are all these people who lose their traditions, what are they going to do? Oh, well, they need some help. Someone explain to them, hey, it's okay. It's okay to lose your tradition. Not a problem. So then those who are not rooted in any tradition, but who are normal, like, you know, totally normal, they can be very helpful. People say, oh, it's okay that I don't have my tradition. Shit, it's better than okay. It's actually helpful. You're not rooted in the dream. Normalcy is not rooted in the dream. It can be reflected in the dream. It's not rooted in the dream. Now, where did I get this clarity? Well, partly from Jesus, but is this the Jesus that seems to be rooted in the Judeo-Christian tradition? No, no. It's a Jesus that knows that. The normalcy is not rooted in that, actually. The normalcy is never rooted in the dream. It's never rooted in any dream tradition. It's always rooted in normalcy and nowhere else. It has no, normalcy has no cause other than normalcy. So that's why Christianity rejects A Course in Miracles. That's not our tradition. It's a lie. It's a deception. What are you talking about? It's not our tradition. They get kind of huffy and puffy about it. But at some point they will certainly need the help. So certainly Jesus recognizes that there's going to be a need for help for those who seem to have lost their traditions. Lost their traditions. Or, whoa, whoa, whoa. I don't know. What can I be rooted in? Oh, normalcy is rooted in normalcy. That's where that's the freshness of it. And then sort of a light can go on and they can say, ah. Oh, this is interesting. I like this. This is very. This could be helpful. Now this is, yeah. So we're getting real close to the situations that could be very interesting. So when the freshness is there, people say, it's too fresh, it's too fresh, it's too fresh. I gotta have that freshness come from tradition and kind of make a little stale. No, it's not rooted in any tradition. It's rooted in itself. Well, that's too fresh. It's too fresh for me. I love it, but it's too fresh. I need to be able to project upon it. I need to be able to project guilt upon it. I need to be able to project special. No, you don't. You don't need to be able to do that at all. That's what we're saying. It's not a need. It's a mistake. Mistakes are not needs. Well, they might say, well, then I can't really hang out with you that much. I can't really bring you, you know. Well, that's okay. Just a little bit goes a long way. I can't really make a big deal about it. They say, well, that's okay. You don't need to make a big deal about it. It's rooted in itself. They might say, well, this freshness can't last. I mean, we need a tradition to make it last. No, freshness is not rooted in the dream of tradition. It is rooted in itself. Normalcy is rooted in itself. Normalcy is rooted in itself and nowhere else. So this is a wonderful practice. New affirmation. Your normalcy is rooted in itself and nowhere else. Normalcy is 100% rooted in itself and nowhere else, without any exception. Normalcy is completely rooted in normalcy. Normalcy is all-inclusively rooted in normalcy. Normalcy is all-inclusively rooted in normalcy. The normal is all-inclusively rooted in the normal. All-inclusively rooted in the normal. These imaginary needs. We say, oh, I need to get to project the guilt. No, we don't need to project the guilt. Why? Because God's love for us is not diminished in any way. We're mistakenly believe that somehow because we're trying to hide the guilt from God, so we don't want God to know about it. You know, it's like, oh, I see, I feel guilty. I tried to do this, God. God knows all about this. God knows God's love for us is not diminished in the slightest bit, so we don't need to try and get rid of the guilt that way, this way, you know, kill the guilt, hide it from God. God doesn't know about it. So we don't have to actually accept that we're rooted in God because we're worried about maybe we lost favor with God and we're trying to be greater, you know. But we did not, we cannot. Perfect freedom is perfect freedom. There's no diminishment of it whatsoever. That is God. That God cannot be anything other than absolute perfect freedom. So that cannot be diminished at all. So we don't have some need to project guilt and try to escape, kill guilt. We don't have any such need. This is a want, a mistake. This is a mistake. Mistakes are not needs. So if someone says, well, I needed this freshness to be less fresh. No, that is not a need. It's a want. And they can always diminish their proximity to it if they want to. They can always go into imagining it's not there if they want to. That's fine. There isn't any need to diminish it. There's no need to diminish it. And indeed, if you try to diminish it, it's not there at all. It becomes a mirage then. Freshness is rooted in freshness. That's why it's fresh. And people say, we don't want this, we want traditional. Well, fine, that's what they want, that's what they want. It's not what they need, though. They don't need it. So in California, we have these mavericks. These mavericks are not, tend to be rooted in anything so much. That's really where all this is going eventually. It's interesting, of course, in Miracles was started in New York City, and a lot of it migrated out into Bay Area, Southern California, California places. In terms of various things that happen and headquarters of this and that and blah blah blah, where it's really 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 free of any tradition, maverick land here. here we go, like some suburban house that probably needs to be remodeled pretty soon. And a few people have been living in it. This house has been around for maybe 20 years, 30 years, or whatever. That's, you know, they're places they go to, places that have been there for 1,500 years, temples, where countless millions of people have been, have meditated, been there, have gone there throughout the ages. See? It's a very different feeling. But as Jesus says, don't try to put new wine into old wineskins. Burst them, you see. So trying to put this type of teaching into the traditions of whatever religion, it just does, it's not going to work. It doesn't work. It's going to burst them. I live in a, of course, predominantly Judeo-Christian tradition in the United States. Of course, the Bay Area is very eclectic. So I try to at least, you know, accommodate that, you know, and acknowledge it, say, how can I, because most people have, that's the background, they obviously want to accommodate it, acknowledge it, etc. But it cannot be put into that tradition. It cannot be put into those traditions. You see, all traditions have a tremendous bias towards the belief that, that at least some abnormality is rooted in this dream somehow. And none of it is. None of it is. And this is, you know, I mean, there's a lot of time worshiping involved in any tradition. There's going to be it accumulates baggage. Understandably so, because it takes a while for time worshippers to gradually, you know, let it go bit by bit by bit. So yeah, that produces a tradition because they're doing it bit by bit by bit. If they did at this instant, where would the tradition be? Right? But we're not here to try to establish some tradition, which really mean be supporting time worshiping. We're trying to encourage us to drop all the time worshiping. Do it now. Now, do it now. Can that be put into any tradition? Not really. No, it cannot, can it? So, in some regards, I've been a slowpoke, you know, unfortunately. Because I've tried to be over-accommodating to traditions, and some fortunately just said, forget it, I'm not interested in that, we'll do it right now. And so that's the right way to go if you can do it. Freshness right now. But where's your tradition? Where are your teachers? You have to have those. No, from freshness right now. Well, we can't have that, we can't do that, we can't. Yeah, well, it's freshness right now. Freshness is completely rooted in freshness. Normalcy is completely rooted in normalcy. Just like whatever is reflected in the mirror is completely rooted in itself and not in the mirror at all. So the opportunity might be just to silence the freshness and just get used to it, that's all. Not try to hook it into some tradition. You don't need to discuss or talk about this tradition, that tradition, this teaching, da, 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 da. Just experience the freshness. And full stop in the wow. I call it wowism, full stop in the wow, the freshness. Just that's it, that's all there is. That's what's on the menu. We have one thing on the menu, but it's freshness. That's a pretty good menu right there. So those who can handle just the one item menu could be a good situation. I hope so. If that's the way things go, I don't know. The freshness of normality. Normality being rooted in normality is the freshness. There's no time there at all. No staleness there at all. I could go for that. I could go for that. I'm just thinking, I go for that. Yeah. So there's no guilt on my mind saying, oh, well, but the freshness, okay, great, but how do you relate that to, you know, this is what you get. Oh, you're enlightened, freshness, perfect freshness. Great, but how do you relate that, you know, but how do you relate that then to the tradition? How do you relate? It's not related. It's related to itself. It's rooted in itself and nowhere else. They try to make it seem, well, that's a nice step, but now the next step is you have to explain exactly how it's rooted in, you know, you know, the one-upsmanship or something. No, there's no next step like that at all. But what they have to experience is how to transition from the idea of what's in the mirror, being rooted in the mirror, to realizing it's not rooted in the mirror. The mirror of time, space, process, and form. And there's nothing rooted in that, actually, at all. Truth is not rooted in any tradition, actually. In fact, reality, you might say, is rootless. Totally root, totally spontaneous, totally rootless. Rootlessness is rooted in rootlessness. Rootlessness, in one way of putting it, normalcy is rooted in normalcy. Freshness does not need to be translated. It needs to be experienced. So freshness does not need to be translated, it needs to be experienced. So it's not that it's people coming, well, my tradition is validated, my tradition is validated. They want their traditions to be validated. How about truth is validated? The rootlessness of truth, truth rooted in truth, freedom is rooted in freedom. How about that being validated through the freshness? All this validates that I don't have to be rooted in any tradition. I'm already rooted in spontaneity, the spontaneity of pure freedom. The traditionless, the tradition-free tradition. I'm already successfully rooted in freedom. I don't need to successfully become rooted in freedom. I call it wow is, you know, yeah, wow. So I would say, if there's anything that can be helpful, advice is simply put yourself into this. Wow, that's all I need to say, or know is just wow. Really, seriously. I don't need to explain. Well, how is this related to radical Dzogchen, and how is radical Dzogchen related to the rest? Blah 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 blah. And just wow, wow. freshness is fresh. Wow. Now, the freshness was still fresh the freshness is fresh in these examples of normalcy, even though they may come within a tradition. But people are usually so into the tradition that they assume that it's not always fresh or something. But if you're not, if an outsider can often come, this is what Normal Anandamayi said, that people complain from the tradition. Hindus complain. They said, there's somebody came from outside the tradition or something, or, you know, they didn't even know you, not part of the family, and they got it like that. And here we are, we're part of your tradition, your family, and we don't get it. What's up? They got really angry about that. And she said, look. you get so used to, get lazy, you get used to things, you not really pay attention, and you're not so keen on it. But somebody else may come along and they recognize, you know, they really, really want it, and boom, they see it like that. You know, they're not, so it's kind of like, it's something like, there might be this beautiful lotus flower, and you just live in the pond, and you're a frog in the pond, and you're busy catching insects, and you're not really paying much attention to the lotus flower. It's just there, you know, it's just tradition. Yeah, tradition is, it's there, we know it's there, that's our tradition, it's there. But someone else come in, and they don't have any such tradition or anything like that, and all they're looking for is that beautiful lotus flower. And they see a lotus flower, and they just recognize it, wow, this is the freshness, I just get it right now. She said, and Normal Anandamayi said, this often happens, actually. So there was no confusion about this tradition situation, very clear about it. But what I was looking for is, does the freshness remain? I say, oh, the freshness is there. I said, okay, I'm not putting any tradition. Is it still there? Is it still there? Is it still there? Is the freshness still fresh? Is this freshness still fresh? And then I realized it's always fresh there. I said, wow. That's all I said, just wow. I don't care about anything else. Is the freshness still fresh? It's still fresh. This is it. This is real then. This is freshness rooted in freshness. This is not some mirage. This is actually the real freshness. I don't care about any tradition, this or that. So that's what's important. So this produces a wow. That's why I'm saying you have to practice this wow. Because when you realize the freshness remains, is still fresh, that hits you hard. That's when the wow hits really strong. I got hit so strong there with Normal Anandamayi. But I realize the freshness remains, is untouched by this world. It doesn't matter what her appearance is or tradition, it completely doesn't matter at all. It's completely, the freshness is absolutely still fresh, it's untouched. Then I realize this is real. This is not a mirage. This is not a mirage of tradition. This is real. And then the wow hit me. It incredibly hard hit me. I said, wow, it is possible. You know, the freshness can be in this world and be untouched by the world. It remains completely fresh. And I got some back talk going on there. Sorry about that. I'm trying to talk over it here. The freshness remains totally fresh. Totally. Well, there you go. It's untouched by what people say. People yelling, get out, I don't like it, blah, blah, blah. Still it remains absolutely fresh and untouched. Then the wow will hit. It will hit for sure. So this is why I say practice full stop in the wow. All these videos are designed to help those of you who are going along with these videos, help getting used to this wow. So at some point going along, at some time, eventually you'll be able to come across real freshness here in the world. Freshness rooted in freshness, normalcy rooted in normalcy, you see. And you will recognize that the freshness doesn't, it remains, it doesn't get diminished. It's still fresh, no matter what anyone is saying or what's going on in the world. And when you recognize that, that is going to hit you like, wow. And if you've already practiced full stop in the wow, you'll just remain there quiet and say, oh, it's fine, okay. I can get used to this. I don't have to do anything. I can just sit here quietly. And you'll start absorbing the truth of this. And then you'll realize the truth of your own being. More and more and more, the truth of your own being is rooted in the truth of your own being. Freedom is rooted in freedom and nowhere else. So all you have to do is just this, wow, you don't have to relate it to some tradition, some mirage of freshness, some time-based mirage of freshness. It's not, no, it's right here, right now. Time isn't touching it. That's the realization. Time is not touching this. Wow. And then you just realize, hey, this is serious business right here. I'm just going to be quiet here. This is reverberating. And you might feel a little unsteady for sure. I'm feeling a little unsteady right now, to tell you the truth. Partially because I haven't eaten breakfast. Blame it on that, huh? But this is hitting hard. This is potent. Well, just fantastic. Just wow. I mean, you feel, we're getting close. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Close is great. Close is great. Closer is great. Don't let it spin into any talk or tradition or mental chatter or spin. No spin. Wow is the no spin zone. You insist upon a no spin zone for this experience of freshness, for your wow. Your wow is very important. Insist on no spin of that wow, okay? I'm absolutely with you on that. I am not spinning this wow at all. I am just present for it. Because you're being present for yourself by doing that. I will not spin this wow into any tradition, into time, into space, process, form, label, concept, anything. I am just full stop in this wow, and that's it. Full stop in this wow, and that is it. So many people in the world, spirits, projecting, imagining themselves in a world on the screen of time, space, process, and form that are feeling very rootless now because the corporation that's run by the CCC, Cosmic Corporate Culture, they're feeling like, well, I've lost my traditions, I feel so rootless. And they may be, attracted to the CCC, trying to desperately get into the bureaucracy of that, get into the tradition of the CCC. Which is even a greater, longer tradition, or really a mesh you into tradition, time, space, process, and form. You don't want that. Well, the option is to sit with this freshness. That's the option, and which is wowism is really the option. Just full stop in the wow, no spin on it at all. I just feel wow. That's it. I'm shocked. That's a beautiful shock. It's like spiritual shock treatment, really. Wonderful, beautiful, just stay with that, that's it. My God, the freshness is fresh, it's not diminishing. Time doesn't touch this freshness, my God, wow. And just stay with your wow, you have the right to your wow. You have a right to be wowed without any spin on it whatsoever. You have that fundamental right. This trumps all the nonsense, all the marketing of the CCC, doesn't it? Absolutely, it trumps it.